April meeting of the Board of Health. All right, we'll call to order and start with the Pledge of Allegiance. If everybody would rise and face the flag, thanks.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Happy spring, everyone. We've officially reached it with today's weather. All right, and yesterday, which was awesome. We will start the meeting with the review of the March minutes, and I believe they are in our packet, and I didn't see anything that looked, thank you, yes, that looked like it was unusual. Anybody have any corrections or changes? Names spelled or anything? I think we're in pretty good shape. Okay, so just a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
So moved in a second.
Second.
Okay, so that's two out of five people, so the other three, all in favor, aye?
Aye.
Aye. They shall be passed, so the minutes for March will be placed on the website. Make sure Larry has a copy of those. Just as far as minutes go, just in general, Linda was asking this month if someone else could help out with minutes and kind of do an every other month thing. I think that'd be perfectly reasonable if somebody else could just kind of chip in and help out with minutes, so if anybody wants to volunteer to help out maybe for the May or June meeting, we'd appreciate it. And the students have been taking the notes?
Yes.
Okay, and then just get sent to a board member, and then we can forward that to the other board member and review them and then get them ready for the meeting. So over the next month, if we want to just kind of communicate by email to share that job up, would be a good idea. Thank you, Linda, for that. We'll move on to the health officer's report. Mr. Tautone, please.
Good afternoon to the Board of Health members, to the members of the community that are here tonight, and those at home. Report for month of March 2017, we had 16 food safety inspections, 8 bathing place inspections, and 10 quality of life issues, ranging from dogs scratching and biting humans to rat complaint. We had one complaint of a food object and food in a food facility, which we investigated. Also, we conducted some training. We attended some training. CASA conference of the food safety professionals. The training was in March the 10th at Conshohocken. Upcoming training will be in June the 13th to the 14th, put on by the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture. And tonight, or this afternoon, our new food inspector, Marie Carbonara, attended training for the ServSafe, which is the first step in her becoming a certified food health officer. So, and she also took the exam today. Upcoming events, we have the Katie Sampson Lacrosse Tournament, which will be on April the 29th. The Wheels of Wayne, which is a great event, which will be April the 30th, the next day. Also, the Carol Axelrod Blood Drive, which will be May the 9th in this very room. And the Wayne Music Festival, which will be June the 10th on North Wayne Avenue between West and Lancaster Avenues. We also have a number of food facilities that are in the various stage of opening. I would like to just kind of, the only time that I do give a plug to a restaurant is when they first open up. So we just opened up today From the Boot, which is an Italian pizzeria located at 134 North Wayne Avenue. Used to be Vecchio's Pizza. Then we have Saffron, which is an Indian restaurant. It's under plan review and renovation. Sasano Pizza, which is 910 Conestoga. La Jolie, it's 18 West Avenue, all three under renovation. Dan, which is on Sugartown Road, which is under renovation. Jersey Mike's, which is now open. And Vic's Sushi, which is 1084 East Lancaster Avenue, used to be Subway, which is under permit. Mr. Chairman, so is my report.
Thanks so much. I would maybe ask for, if you guys don't mind, either you or Ms. Carbonara, next month, could possibly just give us a just a two-minute or three-minute kind of take on what a food inspection is and what you guys are looking for when you head to these restaurants. I think we had an incident, was it last summer or the summer before, I don't remember, where there were some violations, and at that time was really the first time I was exposed to the kind of things that you guys are looking for at these places. Just some general things for us and the community to kind of hear what's done. Obviously, we can go online and look at the reports that you guys make. I'm kind of curious to see how you guys approach the typical yearly inspection of a place, if you don't mind. Maybe we'll talk briefly next meeting about that. Would that be okay?
I'd be happy to attempt that challenge.
Thank you, sir.
I don't know if we can do it in 2 minutes, though.
Well, I mean, whatever it takes, but I'd like to hear a little bit more, and I think the community would like to hear a little bit more about what goes into keeping our restaurants safe and inspecting in our community. Okay. Thank you for that, Larry. As we move on to some old business now, we try to update the community on the Villanova care meetings, the CICD meetings, with any updates about health-related issues. I was not able to attend this month's meeting, and usually I get to review them online, but I was not able to find that on Radnor Television. And just speaking with some community members prior to the meeting, I understand that there has not been an official report yet on the soil samples that have come, allowed by the township to be done. So if we get any updates on that, I will update the public in this meeting forum as well. And I believe it's still the monthly meeting will occur on the first Thursday of the month in May. Is that the timing? I think it was first Thursday of the month.
I think so, yeah.
First Thursday.
They changed it
again? Okay. Let me see. I had the minutes to the meeting. I do. Next meeting, I'm sorry, it says the set meeting date next meeting is Thursday, May 4th, according to their minutes from the agenda from the meeting. I'm sorry, I don't have the minutes, I have the agenda. So unless that's changed during the meeting, I'm not sure. We will find out.
Do we want representation there, or what's your feeling?
I generally, I mean, it's, you know, it seems like the kind of portion of the meeting that the Board of Health was involved with has sort of been settled. They've, you know, the township has agreed to allow soil sampling to be done and paid for. So we're just waiting for the results of that from our point of view. There are other issues, I believe, that the public has concerns about, and we'll certainly get into some of those in the announcement, public participation today. So we'll hear about some of those maybe. But I don't know if we need a specific representative there this month. I'll try to watch that meeting or get the minutes beforehand. Any updates that you know of, Linda, from the student projects? I know I did see a great brochure from Mignon this last month.
No. Not to put you on the spot, do you want to give an update briefly?
We're continuing our work. We started our presentations, working on them. We're still trying to put up our, she's doing a poster, and we're trying to look out, see where we could put them out, still improving them.
Are either of you going to talk in one of the meetings at the end, the June meeting or the May meeting? Did you?
Can we both do June?
Sure. I mean, if they're both under the 5 minute kind of time frame, we can do June for the final meeting of the year.
Yep.
Thank you guys, and after your presentations for your service for the year, that'd be great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I don't think there's any other old business unless anybody had any additions or anything like that, no? Okay, so we'll move on to some new business. I am looking for a presentation then for May. Hopefully we'll have either Larry or Ms. Carbonara speak a bit about restaurant inspections, and if anybody has an issue that they're passionate about and want to talk a 4 or 5 minute kind of presentation about, I'd appreciate it. I will speak with the board members who aren't here this month and get their input to see if they can help us out in the May meeting for a nice little talk for the public. In the Board of Health, we only meet through June, so we'll have a May meeting and a June meeting. We will not have a July or August meeting. In the past couple of summers, we've had a couple of little issues that have occurred in the summertime, and I have communicated via email in years past, and if that's okay with you guys, we'll continue to communicate via email. Sounds good. We all work. We're all busy. It sometimes takes me a couple of days to get back to emails about the board and board issues, and I totally understand the same thing from you folks. If you have issues and you can't get back on an email, if it's something very urgent, we'll note that in the email, but otherwise, please go about your lives, answer your emails when you can, and we'll all be on the same page when we get back together in September. September for our first meeting into the fall. Excellent. So sort of a topic that we discussed last week, but I believe is more of a new business kind of thing. I do appreciate Nancy having formulated this nice little recommendation from the board. Do you have a copy of it I can give you?
I have my phone.
You do? Okay. I printed a copy too. So the printed easier?
I did it twice. So.
That's great. Yeah. So if you could read that for us, yes. And we'll kind of discuss as a board here how we're going to do. And again, to remind people, we did talk last week about making a formal recommendation to the school board, the Radnor Township School Board, to change our sleep times for children.
Okay. In keeping with empirically based recommendations from the National Sleep Foundation, the Centers for Disease Control, and the American Academy of Pediatrics, reflecting research on teen sleep cycles and relationships between teen sleep patterns and long-term health outcomes, the Board of Health recommends that the Radnor School District explore moving school start times for middle and high school students to 8:30 a.m. or later.
And I appreciate it very, obviously well stated. The presentations that we've had, are fact-based from some of these organizations, the CDC and the AAP, the American Academy of Pediatrics, National Sleep Foundation, all have similar recommendations. And I think that as we have in the past, we're not looking to, sow new ground here and make some kind of giant recommendations for the country, but we do review some of the broader bodies' recommendations and see if they would be appropriate for our township, and certainly it seems like that would be an appropriate thing for our township. So in my opinion, this is a great statement and recommendation for the board of for the school board. Mr. Kane, our school board representative, our school representative, couldn't be at the meeting tonight, but did email and said that we would probably filter this through the superintendent of the schools to review this if this was our board's recommendation. As far as the wording goes, anybody have any? I can certainly pass it around and kind of to remind you again, but I think that it's well stated. The only thing that I kind of bracketed out there was, recommending a specific time. Do we just say, a later school start time for our middle and high school children? Or do we give a specific time where we say, it's right now this high school starts at 7:30. Do we say an hour more?
I will note that all three organizations did pick that time.
Any more comments about this kind of thing? And I think that, obviously there's a few more, it's not just us that's looking at this as well, but the state, at the state level, it's going on in the legislature, some debate about this as well. I think that the greater suburban area that we're in, Tredyffrin, East Town, Great Valley, Radnor, Lower Merion, have all also considered some of this at some of their school board meetings as well. So I think it's it's not just us that's going to be commenting on this kind of thing. So, okay. So if there's no other debate about this, I think it's probably something we should formally vote on. And sure, public comment for it. Just come on up to the mic if you don't mind. Thanks.
I just would like to know that the American Academy of Sleep Medicine also came out with the same recommendation this month, if you wanted to add that to your list. Right. Yes, I will read it to you if you want me to. During adolescence, internal circadian rhythms and biological sleep drive change to result in later sleep and wake times. As a result of these changes, early middle school and high school start times curtail sleep, hamper a student's preparedness to learn, negatively impact physical and mental health, and impair driving safely. Furthermore, a growing body of evidence shows that delaying school start time positively impacts student achievement, health, and safety. Public awareness of the hazards of early school start time and the benefits of later start times are largely unappreciated. As a result, the American Academy of Sleep Medicine is calling on communities, school boards, and educational institutions to implement start times of 8:30 a.m. or later for middle schools and high schools to ensure that every student arrives at school healthy, awake, alert, and ready to learn. And that's from the Journal of Clinical Sleep Medicine, the latest edition.
Thank you. One more board to agree, and they like to give a time, which is fine with me. I just didn't want to put restrictions on the board. but I think that's very reasonable to suggest an hour later for the high school students would be helpful. So if that's okay with everybody, we'll add on, and we'll type that in there and make the formal recommendation as in keeping with empirically based recommendations from the National Sleep Foundation, the Centers for Disease Control, American Academy of Pediatrics, and the American Academy of Sleep Medicine, reflecting research on teen sleep cycles and relationships between teen sleep patterns and long-term health outcomes. The Board of Health recommends that the Radnor School District explore moving school start times for middle and high school students to 8:30 a.m. or later. And we'll bring it to a vote if anybody has motion to bring it to
approve.
Motion to approve.
I'll move.
Thank you, Nancy.
Second.
Thank you. And all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
An aye as well. Okay. It sounds like the ayes have won. Any nays? No nays. So 5-5. All right. So we will formally type this up and get this to the superintendent. Nancy, I thank you so much for writing this for us. Another piece of legislature move through our, we're just moving through this stuff.
So are there school board meetings? Would this be an opportunity to present something like this to the school board? Mm-hmm. Have a representative? Just, I'm not sure the process or how that.
It's been done yet. I'm not sure. Has the school board heard from you folks, Ms. Winters?
The school board has heard last year from a couple of students. The school board has heard from some of the parents. The school board has had the opportunity to attend some of the sleep forums, but not all school members attend all of those forums and have heard of all those opportunities, although I think they're aware of the situation. And I believe the last meeting, Representative Charlton, who was one of the co-sponsors of one of the legislations to do a statewide study on student sleep time, was at the school board meeting and mentioned his support of this, this kind of study, but not necessarily the given recommendations that you're making. So I think it never hurts to send someone from the Board of Health, and you can provide comment at the beginning of the meeting and leave. You don't have to wait till the end.
Thanks so much. Okay, and the other thing we were talking about a little bit last month was the chicken ordinance, just sort of a brief, little recommendation for the Board of Commissioners about having chickens on our properties in Radnor Township. We're going to work on that a little bit more over the next month or two. Okay, so we'll get to that hopefully in May, and figure out how to get this legalized in the township for chicken rearing. All right, so we'll bring us to our presentation for the day. Dr. Capuzzi, thank you very much for getting a presentation together. It looks like it's, is it about other insect-borne illness? Just it's Lyme, okay. I didn't know if we were having multiple insect-borne infections or just Lyme.
No.
But Lyme is the right way to be this time of year. I think I pulled four off me on Saturday or Sunday doing lawn work.
Is this on? So, Lyme disease, a matter of TikTok, and this is a play on words, but you'll see what I'm talking about. Think about the clock. So this is a picture of most of the parasites that affect dogs. The reason I'm showing this is, I want you to see mange, sarcoptic mange. These are mites. They're disgusting. People can get sarcoptes. It's a zoonosis. Tapeworm, all the different worms, tapeworms, roundworms, hookworms, whipworms, completely, completely disgusting. Fleas are just a nightmare. I tell people it's the second worst diagnosis I can give them after cancer for their dogs. They're impossible to get rid of. They attack people. They infest homes. They are a nightmare. Heartworms. I don't have a cursor. Heartworms will kill dogs. But the one that's most feared of anything, people are obsessed with ticks. There is I don't know if it's arachnophobia or something. Actually, the most interesting part of this picture, this was a real movie, and Jimmy just told me that was Mickey Dolan's daughter of the monkeys. So probably the most fascinating part of this picture. But people really are obsessed with ticks, terrified of ticks. People who come into my office. They bring the ticks in bags, and you know, it's sort of ridiculous in a way. It's like a primordial fear, but in a way there is some merit to it. In Pennsylvania, there are five choices of ticks, five different ticks that you will encounter in Pennsylvania, really only two that you'll ever encounter, but five possibilities. The first is the American dog tick, Dermacentor variabilis. I wish I had a cursor. I can't on the mouse. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. I didn't see it there. Okay. So the American dog tick, what distinguishes it? And it's an important distinction because if you find a tick on your dog or on yourself, you can put your mind at ease that it's not a Lyme tick, if you understand the difference. This white shoulder plate is on the American dog tick. It's not likely to bite you. It will bite your dog. It will implant on your dog. It transmits tularemia and Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Second tick, the brown dog tick, you're less likely to encounter. You can see it's a homogeneous tan color. The legs are straight out, and they're sort of beaded, as opposed to the other ticks where the legs are sort of curled. The brown dog tick, for some reason, lives in kennels. It's sort of an indoor tick. They come up from the south. There are a lot of them in the south, so a lot of these dogs that come into the kennels and the shelters end up, spreading these brown dog ticks. And the brown dog tick can transmit Rocky Mountain spotted fever, more likely to bite a dog than a person. The third tick is the Lone Star tick, Amblyomma americanum, and it gets its name from this white spot. It's ovoid versus the other ones that are longer, and it can transmit Ehrlichia and tularemia, and it's an aggressive tick, but it will preferentially bite dogs versus people. The next tick is a non-issue for any of us, only groundhogs. It's host-specific. And then the last tick, which is the most feared of all, the Ixodes scapularis tick. This is the Lyme disease tick. Its original name was Ixodes damini, which they should have probably kept, like damn tick. But they changed it to Ixodes scapularis because the black shoulder plate. And it's also called the black-legged tick. You can see it has black legs and they're curled. It's also called the Lyme tick, the deer tick. In addition to Lyme disease, it also transmits babesiosis and anaplasmosis, which are parasites of the blood. So they cause blood cell destruction. So the difference between these two ticks, these are the two ticks you're going to encounter. Know the difference. It's a simple one. Black shoulder plate, this is the Lyme disease tick, and white shoulder plate, this is the brown dog tick, the American dog tick. These are virtually the only two ticks you're ever going to come in contact with. You'll see them on your dog, and you'll see mainly the Ixodes tick on yourself, sometimes the American dog tick. The white plate will not transmit Lyme disease. The one with the black plate will. Okay, so the size of the tick. Does the size of the tick matter? The size of the tick does not matter. Most people believe that the Lyme tick is the size of a pinhead and the other ticks are non-issue, and that is simply not true. All these ticks can range in size from a pinhead to a watermelon seed, depending on if they're engorged and having been eating or depending on their life stage. So in our area, to repeat, if the tick is implanted on your dog, it could be one of four ticks. They transmit other rickettsial diseases, as well as Lyme disease. And if the tick is implanted on you or a human friend, it's basically going to be one tick, the Ixodes deer tick. This picture is a little misleading because its purpose is to show you the size of a tick compared to a dime. And really, this doesn't matter because it can be all different sizes compared to a dime. And if you remember what kind of tick this is, straight legs that are kind of beaded, variegated, and a white plate. This is the American dog tick. So you can see the, depending on how long the tick has been feeding, it can range from a tick that has not eaten to like 7 or 8 times its size. So this might be a tick that's been feeding for one day. This might be a tick that's been implanted for a couple days. And this is a tick that's ready to drop off. They drop off it after they're implanted 3 or 4 days. So this is a full tick. You can see the range in the size based on how long they've been feeding. And this tick is, if anybody can remember, do you know what this tick is? This is the kennel tick. No, this is the brown dog. Ugh. This is the brown dog tick. It has straight legs and pretty much all mahogany color. And this is the deer tick. The one on the left has not been eating. The one on the right is engorged, and you can see the black shoulder plate. And I've lost the cursor, but you can see the black shoulder plate right there. And the curled legs, the curled black legs. The Ixodes deer tick, the other thing that causes them to be different sizes is the life stage. This is a larva. You'll virtually never encounter it. This is a nymph. They're all over the place in the spring. And even in February, they were all over the place since it was very warm winter. This is the female. Only the females bite. Only the females suck blood, not the males. And again, you'll see the black plate. But the most important thing to recognize is the difference in size between the nymph and the female. So the deer tick can look like all different things size-wise. Deer tick is sort of a misnomer because the deer is actually a poor host for the deer tick. The deer are not the animals that bring them to your front door and into our yards primarily. What does are these little guys, rodents, moles, rabbits. Well, rabbits aren't rodents, but rabbits, groundhogs, other things. Ground-dwelling birds like robins carry them to your front door. But this is the main villain. The main culprit is the white-footed mouse. This is the true spreader of deer ticks. They should be called white-footed mouse ticks, but that'd be too hard to say. So this is the life cycle of the ticks. It's very important to understand. The eggs hatch in the summer. The larvae take a blood meal from a small rodent host. And then they turn into nymphs, and then they take another blood meal, and then they turn into adults. And the nymphs or the adults can feed on people or dogs or anything. And then after they take their last blood meal, they lay eggs, and then the whole cycle continues. So the most important, if you only remember one thing from this presentation, and you guys probably all know this, is that it is not called Lyme's disease. It's called Lyme disease. I would say of every 10 people who come in to the clinic, I would say 9 call it Lyme's disease. It drives me crazy. But I don't say anything to them. But it drives me crazy. Okay. So in 1975, in Old Lyme, singular, Connecticut, there was a cluster of children diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. And In 1977, the condition was then linked to the Ixodes scapularis tick. I think at the time it was called the Ixodes damini tick, but it was the Ixodes scapularis tick, same tick. It still wasn't clear how this tick was causing this disease. In 1981, Willy Bergdorfer discovered the bacteria that came from the ticks that was causing Lyme disease. Oddly enough, as far as back as 1883 in Germany, skin lesions associated with what is believed to be Lyme disease were described. So this is the bacteria. It's called Borrelia burgdorferi. It is a spirochete. It doesn't survive in the environment. It literally has to go from the tick to the host. So what do you think the number one question people ask about ticks is? Number one Lyme disease question, tick question. Getting it out. Yeah, getting it out. Getting it out. But the number one question, which is part of getting out, is, oh my gosh, I think I left the head in. What if I left the head in? What happens? Will we die? No. will the dog die? No. It doesn't matter if the head is left in. It will get extruded by the body. It's not going to get infected. Nothing bad will happen. And the head will not transmit Lyme disease. There is one important question. It's the question nobody asks and nobody really thinks about. The most important question after a tick bite is, how long was the tick implanted? So if somebody was gardening 3 days ago and they have a tick, and all they've done in the last 3 days is go in and out of their car, it's likely the tick, and if it's the tick is fully engorged, it's likely the tick's been there 2 or 3 days and can transmit Lyme disease. It takes a minimum of 24 hours for Lyme disease to be transmitted, usually 36 to 72. So the bacteria lives, if I can find this cursor again, the bacteria lives in the midgut. And it takes at least 24 hours to go into the salivary ducts along the side and into the salivary gland where it can then be transmitted. So if a tick is walking on a person or a dog, no, it can't transmit Lyme disease. If a tick is implanted but in flat, it's probably only been implanted for a few hours. You take it off and forget about it. It's not going to transmit Lyme disease. Theoretically, maybe, but not likely. So, Lyme disease progression. The incubation period for Lyme disease for clinical signs to show up is 2 to 5 months. A positive test can occur as early as 2 weeks after the bite, after a suspected bite. The clinical signs for a dog and for a person, I mean, a person's not so much lameness, but achiness, lameness, joint swelling, and large lymph nodes, lethargy, fever, same signs for a dog and a person. Bell's palsy in people where a side of their face droops. Only 5 to 10% of infected dogs ever show signs of sickness. Erythema migrans is this bullseye that everyone talks about. It's sometimes seen in people. There's a lot of discrepancy as to how commonly it occurs. And, you know, if a tick is on the head, you're not going to see it anyway. But the estimate is 30% to 80% of the time. So seeing it is a big red flag. Not seeing it doesn't really mean that there is or is not Lyme disease. Sometimes it's seen in dogs, but very rarely. I don't think I've ever really seen it in a dog. Because they have hair. The worst sequelae of Lyme disease can go to the heart, neurological problems, and also arthritis, arthropathies. In dogs, the worst consequence is Lyme nephropathy, which the immune complexes go to the kidneys and lodge there, cause kidney disease, and can cause death. And it's more common in labs and goldens. There is a chronic state because the Borrelia will go right from the bloodstream into the tissues and hide out in the tissues. So even treating with antibiotics doesn't always clear it. And so it can, almost like the herpes virus, it can come out with time, so you can get recurrences of Lyme disease. And this is true of dogs and people. So to diagnose it, in humans and dogs, and I just want to say cats don't get Lyme disease. Their bodies are just not friendly to the bacteria. So the bacteria just does not take hold in cats. So in humans and dogs, you should wait 3 or more weeks after the suspected bite or exposure. In dogs, there's a SNAP antibody test against a certain antigen called a C6 peptide. It's 94% sensitive and 96% specific. So as you can see, there's a high rate of false positives and false negatives. In dogs, the other problem is 90% of dogs in a, there's a 90% rate of Borrelia exposure in endemic areas. So this is an endemic area. So potentially 90% of dogs will be exposed to ticks, and a large portion of those dogs are going to have the antibodies. It doesn't mean that they even have the bacteria inside them. They've just, their bodies have reacted to it. So it doesn't tell you if they have it in them or if they're even clinical. In humans, there's an antibody test for IgM, which is current infection, and IgG, which is past infection, by ELISA. And then if it's positive, there's a Western blot to confirm a positive. And it's more complicated in people. It's like the number of bands, the antibodies that correlate with whether or not it's a true positive. So it's very difficult to interpret Lyme disease testing in dogs and in people. I think people, it's even harder. Lot of false positives and false negatives. And again, the reason there is no antigen test, which would make the problem a lot simpler if there were antigen tests, is because you can't rely on it. The bacteria do hide out in the tissues, so blood work would not catch that. Humans and dogs, the treatment is antibiotics, tetracyclines or penicillins like doxycycline or amoxicillin. It takes in 2 to 3 days, usually the person or the dog is feeling better, the dogs are acting different. Treatment is a minimum of 21 days, sometimes 28 days, and it's sometimes repeated. And of course, there can be a recurrence of clinical signs if the bacteria is hiding in the tissues, and treatment might need to be repeated. Where there's suspected exposure, sometimes doctors will put the person or the dog on antibiotics just sort of as coverage. So you keep in mind that a positive test does not always mean disease. A positive test could stay positive forever because it's an antibody test, and treatment may not ever clear the organism. To prevent, the best thing to do, tick avoidance. You can either avoid the areas where there are ticks, wear long pants, long sleeves, socks, white clothes so that the tick shows up, white socks. If you're doing daily body checks, whether it's on yourself or on the dog, which I tell people to do all the time, check the dog every day. If you take the tick off before 24 hours, it's virtually almost impossible that they're going to get Lyme disease. You can use topicals, topical on your dog, topical preventives like Frontline or Advantix. The drops are placed on between the shoulder blades and they spread through the dermis. They can take 2 to 3 days to become effective. They'll kill the tick within hours, and it lasts for 30 days. Not my favorite, to be honest, because I don't really, my personal preference is not to have the chemicals getting on the furniture or my kids, but you know, I do recommend them all the time. But what I like better are the newer oral products like NexGard. So it's a pill, and then you don't have to worry about coming in contact with the with Frontline or any of those other topicals. vaccines. There was a vaccine for Lyme disease. It was discontinued in 2002 because I think it just didn't sell very well. There is a canine vaccine. It's used all the time. Sort of has somewhat questionable efficacy. And one of the issues is what antigen to use in the vaccine. So that's a possible issue. There are different OSPA, OSPC, different antigens on the bacteria that are considered more effective than others. So anyway, it's there's questionable efficacy and also possible link to immune-mediated, to autoimmune disease that has been talked about. It's not anything that's been shown. Do you remove your deer from your yard? No, only if you're worried about your garden. Just a little bit about the epidemiology of Lyme disease. It's the most common tick-borne disease in the world. It's in the U.S., Europe, Australia, China, and some other countries. In the U.S., 300,000 diagnosed human cases a year. In Europe, there are much fewer, 65,000 diagnosed human cases a year. In 2015, the CDC found that 95% of confirmed Lyme cases came from 14 states, Connecticut, Delaware, Maine, Maryland, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Vermont, Rhode Island, Virginia, Massachusetts, New York, New Hampshire, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. In New Jersey and Pennsylvania, for dogs, there have been over 1,000 cases diagnosed annually. This number just seems very low. Anyway, geographic distribution, as you can see, it's mostly in our area in the Northeast and also New England. And see, that's Radnor Township. And I think our building's right here. Lyme disease diagnosed cases are on the rise. As you can see, 1995, about 12,000 to now about 30,000 and there was an all-time high sort of 2007, 2008, 2009. But anyway, there's an upward trend in diagnosed cases. Why? There's increased testing. There's more testing. So we don't know. Is it actually more cases? Who knows? Versus more diagnoses. There is increased testing. If you break a nail, the doctor tests you for Lyme disease. Or you request being tested for Lyme disease. I know I've been tested for it, and I didn't have it, but it's sort of a test that's often ordered. Is there overdiagnosis? Most likely. And it's probably just for the purpose of being conservative, because these test interpretations are so confounding that sometimes it's safer just to put a person or a dog on a 21-day course of antibiotics. But there are truly are warming trends. I know this winter I found ticks on my dogs throughout the winter, every month. So the more ticks, the more exposure to Lyme disease. And if it's warm, the ticks do not, go into hibernation. Mouse populations are also on the rise. So that's it. Any questions?
Thanks, Joan. Great presentation. I appreciate it. I'll, kind of give a couple of cents about pediatrics, because that's what I do every day. I got to be honest, I think that Lyme diagnosis is underdiagnosed because, and two reasons. I mean, one of the things that I always mention is that in pediatrics, almost all of our Lyme cases we find tend to be with the erythema migrans rash. The erythema migrans rash doesn't only occur at the site of the tick bite, but it can migrate around the body. So we find in children who were, as adults, we're bathing our children, we're seeing them in their skin, we very often find those rashes quickly, a week, 2 weeks after they're exposed to the tick, and it's easily diagnosed that way and treated. And I would mention that when you see a child in the office with Lyme disease via rash, we don't report those. And in fact, because Delaware County doesn't even have a health department, there's not a mandatory reporting of that kind of disease to the county. So I think we're even undercounted in this
township.
Because of this township, in this county, because of that very fact. In Montgomery County, in Chester County, if we send off a blood test on a child that lives in that town, we get a letter back from the county that says, did this child have Lyme? What were the test results? Huh. What were the diagnostic clues that you decided to get the testing for? So I believe in those counties, there may be a little bit more honesty to those numbers. Mm-hmm. But as we move from town to town in different parts of the East Coast here, I would assume that there's many, many physicians that treat based upon rash and end up never reporting those cases.
Is that considered something that's recommended, that if you see the rash, the erythema migrans, just to treat and not test?
The current thinking in PEDS is, and this is by the American Academy and the red book is written by the American Academy of Pediatrics, the recommendation is, the Lyme rash is diagnostic. There's no need to test for that. You got the rash, you get treated for, and it's a debate on the number of days, probably 21 days if the Lyme rash is present.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It would be interesting to look at that rash and to have every, blood tests sent out and see if they're actually really positive, because truly, and I see this with dogs, the nature of inflammation is where the tick bite is. Sometimes a certain number of days after that, they will have a red ring. And that actually, and we test them all, but actually a lot of them do come back negative. And because I think just the inflammatory response itself sometimes looks like erythema migrans, but is it actually? And I do question that.
I agree with you. And that's a very difficult diagnosis to make at the tick bite site oftentimes, because people have reactions to bug bites for many reasons. And I think it's more of when we see them away from the tick bite site.
Yeah.
It's fairly, there's not many things in pediatrics that has that ring-like structure that you mm-hmm. can't feel, that really has this under the skin kind of look to it. It's pretty, pretty distinctive in PEDS, and I think that's an important reason that the EAP recommends just treat these kids when you see that in these endemic areas. Now, that's when we get into testing, it's very confusing too, like you said. It's all about checking for people's antibodies or is no test to see if you have the disease, just a test to see if your body is responding to the disease. So the tests are confusing. When we end up testing people for no reason, that's when we get back a lot of these false positives and we're not sure. So if they have symptoms, testing's appropriate, but if they don't have symptoms, not so much. Just because my fingernail got cracked, I don't necessarily recommend you get Lyme testing done. But it really a great presentation and something that I think as a community, obviously they're everywhere. And, the number of Lyme cases that we see in a small practice in Chester County, it's pretty fascinating how many cases a year we see. It's pretty fascinating stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, thank you. Awesome. All right. Couple of quick announcements for everyone before we finish up here today. We have the, as Larry mentioned, May 9th in this room, the Carol Axelrod Blood Drive. Great cause. Donate some blood, please. Remember, the Township Building year-round has a drop-off box next to the police station downstairs in this building for medications. We're bombarded in the news with this every day, and which is good. We are in a crisis in this country with opiates and just medication sitting around the house that you're not using anymore are a source of bad things getting into the community. So please drop them off in the drug drop box in the Township Building anytime. And the Valley Forge Military Academy is having a health fair on, here it is, Friday, April 28th, 12:45 to 2:45 p.m. Mr. McCaffrey, thank you so much for representing the board there. They are going to set up a table for you. I have an email and a contact name, and they will have a small place for you to sit. Hopefully people in the community will just come up and bring up their ideas or questions or concerns about for the Board of Health to address. You don't need to address anything there. You don't have to give them any answers, but bring back a report if anybody does say something to you. I have walked around different events in the Radnor Township over the years and solicited questions from people. So hopefully someone will give you some questions. Any other announcements from anyone?
Mr. President,
yes, sir.
Before Phil left, I checked in with him. The care meeting for May is canceled. The next meeting's June, and also the sampling at Villanova is being done this week.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mayo. And any comments from the public before we adjourn today? Seeing none, seeing one, again, I'm sorry, Ms.
I wanted to thank Dr. Capuzzi for her fine presentation. Having been a victim of one of those little bugs, I appreciate your efforts to inform the public. And I also would like to ask if and when the Department of the Board of Health is advised when there is perhaps a development in the township that might impact public health and safety. I know we've talked about the CARE project. I appreciate what you've done, the CARE committee and the Villanova issues and what your intervention there. And I have on my notes that the soil testing is to be done on 413 and 417, I believe, something like that. And they're supposed to have the reports in mid-May. So you might want to know that so that when you want to follow up, that was the latest I heard at the CARE committee, because I just happened to find my notes of the meeting in my bag. And also, I know one of the other things that Villanova was looking at, and I think it's going to go to the zoning board, and I'm not sure it's going to get approved, but they are planning on a temporary inflatable cover for the soccer fields. I think it's called a bubble or a dome. And I know they're going to require for that kind of a facility to have generators to keep it inflated during its operation between November and April, and I don't know what kind of noise that will provide to the residents, and also if what the air quality might be if the generators are run by diesel or gas or electric. So I don't know when the Board of Health is advised about any of those kinds of developments, and if so, how do you find out to see if there might be something we can do proactively rather than retroactively? That would be helpful, because I think there was lots of development going on in the community, and I know one of the other things that's happening is they're also doing water testing downstream, which is through the Environmental Advisory Committee. So I think all those things are important as we look at development in our township, and I do appreciate all your work and also your efforts to encourage our school board to look at later start times. Thank you.
Ms. Winters, just to address that too as well, I would like to say, you know, a lot of the issues that we've addressed with the Board of Health come from the public. There's no specific way that other boards generally contact us or things that happen in the township. In fact, we've tried in the past couple of years to have the school more active in informing the board if there's an outbreak of a disease in the school, like pertussis, for example, or something else that would, you know, would come through the schools, because I think that the board can then provide a more proactive role rather than a reactive role. So I think that it's a, you know, great example that you folks have come to meetings and given us your opinions and your concerns, and then we've gone and researched them, and that goes for anybody in the public. If there's a concern about the health of the township, please approach Mr. Taltone, I think, has an email address and from the township, and we can get in contact if there's any issues, correct? Or is there is a specific email address that they use?
Yes, it's my email address, LTALTON@radnor.org.
Thank you so much again. And we're always happy to look into these things. So again, thank you all for attending. Let's get out to the nice weather and adjourn until May 15th in this very room on Monday, May 15th at 5:30 p.m. Thank you.